Okej, okay. Hello everybody. Ahoj, dobrý den. Jsem rád, že tu teď mohu být. I will start from the first PowerPoint of my presentation to let you know about the topic of my lecture. The topic is an example of media selection with the AHP and Super Decision Software application. It is about analytical approach to marketing decisions then. And I will start from the first slide. From this first slide, which is actually telling about the problematic aspects of decision making, and that we have different preferences, different arguments. So there is a kind of sea of indecision that we are meeting during negotiations, for example, decision making. And there is a huge need for the opportunities and tools, first of all, to help people with decision making process. And probably I will start from the known fairy tale. It is Alice from Dreamland, that it is very important what you want to achieve in our life. Again, it is very true also in decision making, not only in the business, but also in the private sector, also in the personal life. It doesn't matter actually which tool, which way we take, if we don't know actually where we are going to. So the advice, as you can see here, of the main hero in this fairy tale was that it doesn't much care which path to take in when you don't know where you are going. That's why I will start from the, I will move to the next slide which is the presentation of some problem, the problem description. We will start from problem and I will show you step by step how problems like that can be solved using different approaches. So let's assume that some management of the company XYZ, and a manufacturer of inexpensive, easy to operate digital cameras wishes to introduce its new line of cameras nationwide. And he, this company, the management, has a problem because they have only $1.5 million budgeted for a 12-week campaign to promote the cameras in national consumer magazines. So the company XYZ has already narrowed the field of alternative magazines and has decided to take advantage of reduced advertising rates for the 12-week period. And these rates are shown in table one. As you can see on this slide, we have pre-selected newspapers that this company chose. Potentially, they can place this advertisement in these vehicles. It is National Geographic, Newsweek, Southern Living, People, Sports Illustrated, Travel and Leisure, Time, and US News. As you can see, also, we have some information about the readership and the cost of the advertisement placed in the particular newspaper. It is the cost for 12-week campaign. So as you can see, for example, National Geographic, if we decided to place the advertisement in National Geographic, it will cost the company $346,080. Also in this table, we have the total readership of the newspaper that informs us about the attractiveness, let's say, of the particular newspaper. Obviously, we want our advertisement to reach as many readers as possible, because it is in our interest. So, for example, National Geographic, we can expect that 21 million people, potential readers, will read our advertisement within 12 weeks. Okay, and our assignment is to select the most effective magazines from those that are presented in a table one, and also fit in the budget. So we have some cost limits. The limit of our cost is $1.5 million. So we would like to select these magazines in the way that we will maximize one criterion, which is in this particular example, the readership of the magazine. And we have some constraints, limitations, that we cannot spend more than the budget limit. So the goal, as you can see, is selecting the best magazine the company XYZ would like to achieve. Following the objective, it would like to reach as many readers as possible and not spend more than the total amount budgeted. Obviously, less we spend, it is still okay, but we cannot cross the line. Okay, so we cannot cross the 1 million and a half million of dollars. So, how to solve such a problem? This is the problem that we can name that it is a kind of quantitative problem. And a very basic solution for this problem is, for example, choosing the integer programming method that probably you know from your classes, and formulate some objective, as in our case is maximizing the readership of all newspapers, and our constraints would be to not cross the total amount of budget, which is $1,500,000. This slide presents you the solution of the problem, which I made actually in MS Excel. So this is the standard function that can be used in such circumstances. And you know, you can see that this is some kind of formula that we can apply for the software, which is a maximalization of the readership with some constraints, which are the costs. And then the task is to fit, because integer programming deals with 0, 1 variables. So we, in our case, there are 8 variables. To mix those 0, 1 variables in the way we can maximize the readership, and in the same time not to cross the upper limit budget. So the goal is maximize total readership, and constraints are connected with the costs. And that's all. If you click solve the equation, you will see this is actually the solution that the computer will tell you in this particular case, that we should select National Geographic, Southern Living, People, Travel and Leisure, and US News Magazine. In this case, we have 59,000 potential readers, 7042 during our campaign, and we are below our upper limit, which was 1,500,000, because the 12 campaign in this particular situation would cost us $1,247,286 only. It is quite obvious and solution is delivered without any problem. Let's see what can be improved in this assignment. Let's assume that the company XYZ must now select the most effective magazine subject to the constraint, the same constraint, million and a half advertising budget. But in order to help decide on the best magazine, market research survey and the review of secondary data have been conducted to profile the target market. And the resulting profile of the target buyer follows. Age, we would like to have readers within this age, so it is 18, 44 years of age. Education, at least some college completed. Family, household income, around 30,000 or above, of course. Reads a magazine, so the potential reader would read the magazine at home, not, for example, at work. Research indicates that exposure to advertisement and its communication value is greater rather for in-home than out-of-home readers. So they assume, this is the assumption, that it is better to target the in-home readers than out-of-home readers. And finally, camera buyer, has bought a camera in the last 12 months. As you can see, this constraints or these additional requirements can be also presented and added to our model. And now we can say that in order to create a set of potential target magazines alternatives, the company XYZ could choose from it the best one. Some information is retrieved from secondary sources to determine the audience profile of the 8 candidate magazine with respect to earlier mentions demographic characteristics. The percentage of each vehicle's readership possessing the desired target characteristic are shown in table 2. So we can observe them in the moment, but first let's pay attention that in this task, now in selecting the best magazine, the company XYZ would like to achieve multiple objectives. So not only the objective to maximize the readership, but also to target the right customer. So it would like to reach as many readers as possible as previously, but also target the right type of reader and not spend, of course, this is our limit, the total amount budgeted, so this $1,500,000. We can summarize these requirements, and as you can see, they are expressed quantitatively, but also they are qualitative. So what we mean by quantitative and qualitative variables, that some of them cannot be treated as just numbers, because, for example, let's talk about the age, for example, as the requirement. It is not about maximizing the age or minimizing the age. So it's not the typical constraint that we can say that something must be lower than or equal to something. It is actually between. Also, the in-home readers, the last column of this table, tells you that we target some percentage of home readers. And this percentage is also expressed by the number, but also is a qualitative variable in this case. So it is not also about maximizing something or minimizing something. We would like to take that into account, but it is not a simple integer programming problem that we can just input to a computer and hope that the computer, the software, will give us just the right answer. It's not this is too complicated to design such equation mathematically. So what can we do in such situation that we have both problems that involve both quantitative and qualitative variables? Well, first of all, I would like to tell you about, I must tell you about numbers before we start to solve our solution and to solve our problem, and I will give you some opportunities. I will show you how it is possible to solve problems like that. Let's say, what can we say about numbers at all? Because some people have the habit to crunch numbers, whatever they are. So numbers, the point is that numbers are only numbers. And here you have the example that some elderly couple looking for a town to which they might retire found Summerland, and the sign post read city limit Summerland, population 3001, elevation 208 meters, year established 1870. So totally, total 5079. This is the excellent example of someone that has a sense of humor, because like you see, we can add anything actually. IT guys have a special saying that garbage at the beginning, you will have garbage at the end. So, for example, in the computer, if you put something like rubbish, data that have no meaning at the beginning, you will have some garbage data at the end. Like econometrics is the model. You can have anything actually in the model. Numbers don't have meanings. We need them to have meanings, but they don't have meaning. So actually, we need some tools that can manage our problems in a way that that use some other things that only numbers. And for example, do numbers have an objective meaning? We have different units. Let's say, for example, we can weigh the weight of butter in pounds, like you can see on this slide, or in tons, or in kilograms. Across the world, we have different units. We have different temperatures. We measure temperature outside, inside our homes in different way. We have degrees of Celsius, we have Fahrenheit, we have Kelvins. Now, what, for example, 30 degrees of Fahrenheit mean to New Yorker, and what it means for me, for example? I don't use the Fahrenheit scale, so I don't know 25 degrees of Fahrenheit is warm, is cold, is windy, I don't know. How should I, for example, dress up and go outside? I measure the temperature in Celsius, but I got accustomed to that because we measure in Europe temperature here in Celsius. So we know, for example, that 25 degrees is pretty much warm. 25 degrees of Fahrenheit, I don't know anything about this information. You can have another example of sheep. One sheep can be big, one sheep can be little. Anyway, there are two sheep, because there is no plural in this particular example. We have two sheep, but what is the meaning of that? We have two sheep, but they are different. They are probably as on that picture. So, since we deal with non-unique scales such as pounds, kilograms, yards, pound actually is something that I do not feel. Probably you don't feel also, because it's 0.45 kilogram. But we measure weight in kilograms. We don't measure length in yards, on feet. This is the different measure. We need meters. So if we skip from one scale to the other one, numbers, as you can see, do not tell us anything. Actually, they are meaningless. So such scales, besides such scales, cannot be combined. We need the idea of priority. And priority becomes an abstract, actually unit valid across all scales. It is very important. I don't know if you realize, for example, this today's reality, liter and kilogram is also based on some arbitrary scale. So there is a laboratory, international prototype, for example, of the kilogram made of platinum iridium and declared this prototype shall henceforth be considered to be the unit of mass. So there is strictly denoted for us what is the kilogram or what is the liter. And then actually all we have to do is to compare that what we have with that prototype, this is which is delivered in the by the institution. This is the same time actually with the time. For us, the time runs as it runs, but for the somebody that travels, for example, with the light, with the speed close to the speed of light, it will last longer and longer. Actually, when someone travels, there's an assumption known from the relativity theory of Albert Einstein that if you travel with the speed of light, actually the time for you stops. So that's why perhaps we are, God, for example, can observe us in any moment of our life, because for him or her, the time does not exist at all. So the time exists only for us. We are getting born, we're getting older, and then finally we died. So this is the time that passes by. But there are creatures probably in the space that do not have the time running in the way or feeling the time in the way that we are feeling it. So it is also with the liter, it is also with the mass, so it's also with the time. The time also we have described specifically, it is denoted, and all we have to do is to compare our watches with that what is given, that that and that moment is, for example, 12 a.m., right? So basically decisions are based on judgments, and this is actually one of the most basic of innate human skills, that we are born, that we can distinguish from very beginning, in even we are very small, that we can say if someone is happy or someone is not happy. So we distinguish between smile and frown, right? Even when we are babies. So by breaking up problems and then comparing discrete elements, we are able to have a decision as well as the baby comparing things. Let me picture that for you. For example, we judge. An example is, how do you choose a piece of fruit from a bowl of fruit? Well, probably we will automatically select right now what you are interested in. But if you would like to describe the process that is in your brain, you could say that you identify some characteristic of the fruit. For example, its sweetness, its tartness, its texture, juiciness and size, and on the basis of these characteristics you weigh the priority, so the importance of the priority you selected, and then you after you assign the priority to those characteristics, you select. So you come to the process of selection. The question is, of course, can we just use numbers, for example, to assign these priorities and be done with it? Obviously not, because numbers, as I told you before, do not have meaning. So of course we can, but it would be meaningless. For example, when we say that, for example, sweetness is for us 5 and juiciness is for us 10, or size is, for example, I don't know, 100. And texture is 1,000, it's meaningless what these numbers mean We don't know, actually. So what we can do, actually, we can wait. So in order to select the fruit, we can prioritize the characteristics so they match our value system. For example, compare two of the characteristics which are for us more attractive. Here on the picture, we have the criterion juicy and sweetness. And for example, we can decide that the juiciness of the particular fruit is more important for us that sweetness. Here we have decided that juicy is three times more important than sweetness. At the time, maybe we have different preferences. I can say that, for example, juiciness is for me more important, but for you, sweetness can be more important. It doesn't matter. What matters is actually that we can comparing. It is called in a pairwise mode. We can actually evaluate our possibilities and say, "Hey, I prefer B over A," holding that. In one hand, handling something in one hand, holding something in the second hand, I can say, for me, for example, it is B that I choose. That what I'm holding in my right hand, right, is more attractive for me. It is actually also the very basic way of selecting things and making decisions, not having many alternatives, but having two alternatives and deciding about these two. So we need also the procedure in a case we have many alternatives, and I will provide you such a solution very shortly to what to do if we have many alternatives. Actually, we also can compare them in pairwise mode and then bring them together and denote their priorities. Let's come back to the problem description data. So we have the table one, cost and readership comparison. And we have these newspapers, the same as previously, National Geographic, Newsweek, Southern Living People, and so on and so forth. We have this cost of the advertisement, total readership. And we have also these additional information that we would like this time to take into our account. Consider them as a valuable valuable information in the selection of the right magazine that we would like to take into account. Okay, so these are the same as previously: income, education, age, camera, buyer, in-home readers, right? And I can show you, for example, the solution of that problem, that we can take all of this information and bring them together. It is a solution also in MS Excel, Microsoft Excel, that I used something that is called normalization. And this process is also very unique and gives us the possibility take all numbers and consider them as the meaningful from their perspective, because they are unified in this way. And what means normalization? Normalization means that we have some values, like here, for example, unit readership. These are some numbers, and we can divide. Actually, we can first calculate the sum of all those numbers. The sum of all those numbers in this particular column, 110 and 387, and we can divide each element of this column by the sum of all elements. And then, as you can see, we have something like ratios, and these ratios are meaningful for us because they denote the particular portion that the particular, in this particular example, the particular newspaper takes from the perspective of all elements in the set. So here the set is all newspapers we are taking into consideration, and relative readership is something that we can evaluate how the particular element posts itself among others elements. So for example, we can rank those ratios forming some order. And in the same way, actually, I did also with the income, education, age, numbers about the camera buyer, in-home readers, and I assumed, this is the assumption that will be dropped later, that all these elements, which we have here in the first row, are for me equally important. So I assume that education is equally important as income, that relative, that unit readership is equally important for me as the age. So these are all criteria, and I can assume importance as well. But in this example, I assume that they are equally important. So what I've done, actually, I calculated the mean of all the relatives we have here. So for example, in the 0.1 here result, it is like this number plus this number plus this number plus this number plus this number and plus this number divided by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So if you sum all these elements and you divide it by 6, because there are 6 elements here, you will receive them in all relatives. So, and then I did all the same stuff for all these elements. So in the way that you can see, they are also normalized. So when we add all of them, they should add to 1. And it is true because I checked it. And as you can see also, this is the checking element. It is 1. All I have to do right now, I can rank all of these relatives. So from, for example, most attractive to the worst attractive, or whatever I want, actually. Here you see that they are not ranked yet, because I would like you to see that, for example, the highest rank that I achieved, taking into consideration all variables with this problem, is this ratio. This is the highest ratio that is possible for the Time magazine. So this is the first element, my first choice. Let's say that this is my first choice. The second choice would be 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, if I'm correct. Travel and leisure. Southern is first, living is second, US News is third. So travel and leisure would be the second choice of mine. And for example, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Sports magazine would be the third choice from the perspective of benefits that can come when I place my advertisement in this particular newspaper. However, as you know, these are all benefits. These are all benefits. And we accept of benefits, we have also the cost that we have to fit in. So we need to place the advertisement in the set of magazines that in that way that we do not cross the limit that we have on cost, that we not spend more than $1.5 million. So I did the same with costs, actually. So this is the same numbers taken from the table. As you can see here, National Geographic is 346,080. And here, National Geographic. Where is National Geographic? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Is 346 and 80. And I add all of these numbers again, sum them, and then I normalize them. And after the normalization, I receive also some ratios that are giving me some information about the weight of, if the cost is the weight, so how much money in relation to other magazines I will have to spend on that particular magazine. In this particular situation, you can see that time is pretty much expensive, it is true, and the ratio also is the highest possible from the perspective of the cost. So I have the situations that I have the situation they have some priorities concerning the benefits that placing the advertisement in the particular magazine can give me, and I have also the cost that are incurred in when I place the advertisement in this particular magazine. All I have to do right now is to calculate the benefit cost ratio, which we have here. So divide the benefit ratio by the relative cost ratio, and I will see how the benefit cost will look like. And as you can see, the most attractive alternative from that perspective for our advertisement to be placed in is the Southern Living, because the ratio based benefit cost ratio, so the relation between the benefits and cost is like 37 times more than I will spend on this particular activity. So then far away is living, and then we have US news, and we can rank, of course, all of them. I rank them from the descending order, and as you can see, the number one is, as we decided, Southern Living, then is US News, Travel and Leisure, National Geographic, and People. And actually this is it on when we decide to place any other, to select any other newspaper for the advertisement, it will cost us more than 1.5 million. So there is no other option like select those five. And obviously it is when you compare that result to that what we achieved from the integer programming, you will see that this is exactly the same selection. In the integer programming software also indicated that these newspapers are the best for placing the advertisement, and taking into consideration other variables, we still have this selection that these newspapers are the best. However, in the first place, previously, we took into account only readership and cost of placing an advertisement, and now we took into account many more variables that may have influenced the attractiveness of our advertisement, and probably because I also did some simulations, this result is to be changed when we change the priorities about our criteria, because as you remember, here in this particular situation, I assumed that all these criteria are equally important. However, they don't necessarily have to be like that. For example, we will decide that the readership is much more important for us than, for example, targeting the right client from the perspective of it, of his or her income or education. We can do it actually, but before we will do it, we have to think about how to determine the relative importance of the criteria, like for example here style, reliability, fuel economy, because these criteria concern selection of a car, that is the example. But before we will do it, we should know that in order to determine the relative importance of the criteria, we need to have the scale to evaluate the importance. As we discussed it previously, numbers do not have meaning. So only numbers that we understand in some particular way can be treated as meaningful. So when we have a scale, for example, that if something is equally important, I can assign to this number one. And when I have something that something is extremely more important toward something else, then I will assign 9 to such a 2 elements. Then I can evaluate my preference towards those preferences. So here is the standard scale that actually was proposed by Professor Thomas Satti, that created a tool which is very attractive from the perspective of solving problems like that one, which have not only quantitative but also qualitative variables within the problem, and allows us to solve it and give the meaningful solution. So we have the scale, and we can always then structure the problem. Each decision can be structured from the perspective of the objective you want to achieve, and also the criteria that we will evaluate the importance from our perspective, of course, and also alternatives we would like to choose from. So usually there is something like Karaki proposed, that the objective is at the bottom of this hierarchy, the criteria are somewhere in the middle, and the alternatives we are evaluating and we want to select the best one are at the bottom. Here are some examples. Let's assume that you would like to buy a car. So first of all, we set the objective, select a new car. The criteria would be style, reliability, and fuel economy. And alternatives would be some particular cars like Civic Coupe, Saturn Coupe, Ford Escort, and Mazda Miata. Well, from that perspective, we can form a hierarchy like that one, which consists of 3 criteria and 4 alternatives. Of course, these alternatives will be evaluated from the perspective of each criterion. That's why the same criteria are placed under each criterion, because the very simple way of deciding about our preference towards an alternative is to considering it from the perspective of particular criterion. We should not mix the criteria, because then the process is a little bit chaotic. So it's better that, for example, if we select some A and B, we distinguish those 2 things from the perspective of the unique criterion. And here we have style, reliability, and fuel economy as the criteria. How to evaluate those criteria and how to evaluate those alternatives? Actually, using the scale presented before, we can assess what for us is more important from the perspective of a particular criterion. If I, for example, here someone chose that the reliability is, for example, for that person 2 times more important than style. Style, for example, is 3 times more important than fuel economy. Giving those numbers, we remember in the same time that those numbers mean something, as the 3 is moderately, is a designation of moderate importance, and for example, 5 is designation of strong or essential importance. So if I say that something is strongly more important for me than something else, during the calculation, I can, instead of the sentence, which is accurate in this theory called the linguistic variable, place the number, and the number will denote my preference articulated in the form of the linguistic variable, so in the form of language. So I can do that, and I can form in this way something that is called pairwise comparison matrix. Pairwise comparison matrix, an example of such PCM, you can see here, and it's not important how it looks like, but it's important what is in this matrix. It is actually everything what was done here during the process of evaluation, and I can, for example, tell that this matrix evaluates reliability like 2 to 1 towards style. And for example, I know that the person that evaluated those elements evaluated reliability 4 times more than the fuel economy, and so on and so forth. I will not tell you anything more about the matrix because this is a little bit mathematical and it's not so important for you, because the most important thing is that this calculation and this matrix things, so all this technical stuff can do for you software that I can recommend at the end of my lecture. So how do you turn this matrix into a ranking of criteria? So we have this matrix, some respondent evaluated those criteria in the way that we can see here in the matrix. So this matrix means something, these numbers mean something. Creator of the methodology, which is called the analytic hierarchy process, which is the Professor Thomas Satti, demonstrated mathematically that the eigenvector solution was the best approach in such circumstances. And he described it in the book called The Analytic Hierarchy Process in 1990, and even earlier, in earlier books also in 1980. And the eigenvector solution means that, or connects actually with the process that deals with the raising a particular matrix to some high power. And of course, I can quickly give you the example, but as I said before, it's not for you to understand it right now. Obviously, probably you know how to raise the matrix. So multiply one matrix by another one. So also you know how to raise the matrix to some particular power. But I can remind you that doing it, we simply, for example, if we have 2 matrices and we want to multiply those matrices, so square them, in other words. So in order to calculate this element as a result of the matrix product, we just simply multiply the first element of the first row of the first matrix with the first element of the first column of the second matrix, and then add the second element of the first matrix in the first row of the first matrix with the second element of the first column in the second matrix, and the third element in the first row of the first matrix with the third element of the first column in the second matrix. So as you can see, when we multiply and add all these elements, we will have some results, and this result is the element, first column, first row of the result matrix. And we will do that with all elements. Actually, if you like, you can do it, but also you can do it using the software, like for example Microsoft Excel, that have a function also, has a function also to multiply matrices, and this is just filling out the cells with the numbers and applying that function, and the result is immediate after clicking some button on your keyboard. So it's not really a problem. How to, actually the question is how to compute the preferences out of these calculations. So actually the preferences are computed in this way, that we, after the squaring the matrix and having the result, we add all elements in each row, then we normalize that. Normalization, as you remember, is adding all of them and having some sum, and then dividing each element by the sum of all. So here you have the kind of normalization of the ROM sum provided on the left side of this priority vector, because it is called priority vector. And then actually the idea is to multiply, so multiply the matrix by itself as many times as the difference between these priorities are negligible. So we can square again the matrix that was the result of the first squaring. As you see, we first squared, so multiplied matrix by a matrix, so we squared the matrix, we got some result, we normalized the product, then we squaring again this matrix, so multiply this one by the same one, and we have this one, and then we have again some sum of rows that we are normalizing, and then again we have some priorities, and we compute the difference between these priorities and these priorities received earlier, and we see that actually the difference is negligible. So we actually can multiply the matrix again, but as you can see, no difference to four decimal places would be observed when we would square this matrix. So this calculation obtained is quite pretty reliable, that we can say credible. And okay, and the same thing actually we can do with the other criterion. So as you can see, the criterion that we evaluated gave us the relative ranking as this one. So we evaluated all criteria in the same way, and we have priorities given in this priority vector. And now let's go back to hierarchy tree. And as you can see, our problem is a little bit more clearer because we have the style that is worth for us, let's say 31 or 32 almost percent of the all criteria. We have this reliability, which is worth 55-56% of all criteria, and fuel economy, which is the less important criterion from the perspective of all criteria. So when we weighted all these criteria, we have the evaluation looked like that. And what we are missing actually is that we have to evaluate also alternatives in the same way. So we can do it. Of course, we can do the same evaluation for style. We can do the same evaluation for reliability. And this is the exemplary result, how it looks like. What else can we do? Well, we can evaluate, but this time numerically, because we have some, let's assume that we have some numbers, how many miles can a particular car go per gallon. So we can also use these numbers directly, normalize them, and then receive some ratios. And in this situation, we can put it all together. So our analytic hierarchy would look like this one, that we have priorities of all criteria and of all alternatives under each criterion. Please pay attention that these evaluations are different than these and these, because these cars in alternatives in our model are evaluated from the perspective of the particular criterion. So we differently evaluate the particular alternative from the perspective of style, and differently from the perspective of reliability, and different from the perspective of fuel economy. What else can we do? And this is the end of our game, because now we do some kind of the weighted average procedure. So we weight each alternative preference by the preference of the criterion, particular criterion. So we weight the matrix with all alternatives weights by the weight of all criteria, and we receive the final ranking. From that perspective, for example, the Miata is the highest ranked car, because this is the highest priority we received during this evaluation. However, we have also other side of the coin, which is that not only benefits must and can be taken into consideration, because from the perspective of benefits, Fiat Miata won, but what about costs? Cost of each car. Well, technically we should begin from benefits, because if we begin from costs, things like that could happen in our company. So the costs should be taken into consideration later at the end of the process. So taking it into consideration costs, we can calculate our preferences directly from numbers. So do what I did previously with the vehicles for our advertisement magazines. So normalize the costs, calculate the ratios, and calculate the benefit to cost ratio. And from that perspective, not Miata, but the Civic is the winner with the highest benefit to cost ratio. So we can interpret it as the relation between that what we get and that how much we have to pay for it. So the more we get and less we have to pay for it, is more attractive for us when this ratio is higher, right? So as you can see, this is exactly the same situation. Like I was proposing here to solve the problem with the vehicle magazines. And now I would like to tell you how to improve this solution with adding some preferences towards each criterion that in my solution were actually averaged. So the assumption was that they are equally important here. Yeah, as I told you before, they not necessarily have to be equally important for the company or for the management of the company to in such a situation from the perspective of the problem that the management has to solve. And the example of media selection with the actually analytical hierarchy process and super decision software application can be presented like this. And maybe now I will show you the software because I would like you to see that there is a particular software that can be used to solve problems like that. So perhaps right now I will stop sharing the presentation and share with you the software that I would like to show. You could see how to solve such problems like that within the software that can ease us the calculations and comparisons like we previously demonstrated. And the software called Super Decision and is available freely by a foundation of Rosanne Sati, which is the wife of deceased Thomas Sati that created the analytic hierarchy process. And as you can see, I also introduced the problem that I presented at the beginning of my presentation into the software. So we have the objective, like selection of the medium. And we have some criteria, age, camera buyer, education, in-home readers, and also alternatives. And all I have to do solving the problem in the software is to evaluate the alternatives from the perspective of the preferences. And this is done like this in the software. And I click on the particular window. And you see that the preferences of the particular vehicle can be evaluated from the perspective of graphical evaluation, verbal evaluation. Also, I can put some numbers in the matrix equation or questionnaire or directly as numbers. As you see, numbers here are exactly the same as here because this reflects the priorities. So for example, you can see that if, for example, from the perspective of age, because this is our criterion here presented I evaluate, let's say, National Geographic more than Newsweek, look at the right side of the monitor, how our preferences will change, actually. You see, now the Newsweek is evaluated more than the National Geographic, and the strength of this evaluation is presented by this blue and red rows at the bottom of the circle. The same, of course, can be expressed in words: extreme, equally moderate, strong, or by the questionnaire, when one is equally important and nine is very strongly important. So if I change something here, as you can see, immediately I have the changes in the priorities. So it is very easy also tool for sensitivity analysis. I can change also the criterion. Let's evaluate, for example, alternatives from the perspective of income. We should see the evaluations. You can see them here graphically. They are almost equally important, or verbally or numerically. So you can see this is pretty easy in the software, and actually you can use it because you can download the software for free from the web page that I can show you right now. I guess I will stop presenting the software and present now the web page. You should see www.superdecisions.com, and you have the web page that is devoted to all AHP and NAP, which is the development, ANP, which is the development of AHP, actually, because AHP stands from the analytic hierarchy process and ANP stands from the analytic network process. But you have everything what you need actually on this page, with together with tutorials, with manuals, and of course sample models that you can use to play with the software. Of course, if you want more, you can use also another page, which is the page of the RWS publications, and find some books concerning the AHP and ANP. Right now, I will also, okay, I'm about to end. I will stop presenting and come back to my slides.
Okay, I would like to say thank you very much to Mr. Kazibudzki. It was an interesting lecture, and I would like to say to students that we will continue. We will have one more lecture at 2:15, so please join us. There will be different lecture, branding as an integral part of marketing, which is the topic that we will discuss later. But this topic will be presented by Mr. Pronay from University of Szeged from Hungary. So please join us at 2:15. Here you have a link inside the Microsoft Teams. So thank you so much again, Pavel, for your
thank
lecture.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. I'm very glad that I could be here. Once
thank
again,
you too.
Warm greetings to you. Thank you so much for everything. Děkuji vám za všechno. co jste pro mě udělali.
You're welcome. Okay, perfect. Thank you so much again. And stay safe and healthy. Greetings to Poland. And to students, please be there at 2:15. Okay, see you later. Goodbye.
Goodbye, bye-bye. Nashledanou.